This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We welcome you this day as we observe the second Sunday after Pentecost. And we thank those who help with our service today, for Micah, for Acolyte, but especially Kay for coming in and playing the organ for us this morning as we worship together. And Derek and Leah for continuing to post our services at our website and also on the Facebook page. The order of service today is on page 184 in your hymnals, if you're able to follow along with the hymnals, or you can download a copy there at our church website. We encourage you, as these last weeks we've been getting restarted, now we have four services of 25 and under that members are signing up for and participating in, that you would let us know if we are still serving our community by means of these online services. That is to say, as we make decisions going forward with the elders and I and the church council about our services, we'd like to really know if anyone is still using the online services for our Sunday morning worship and also our Bible studies, our midweek Bible study. So if you would, you could just sign your name in to let us know, or however you would like to do that. You can call the church office if you would like to do that. But it gives us a means of gauging our service to our church family. And we want to make sure that everyone, even those who for very good reasons, maybe medical reasons or otherwise, aren't able to come to church, that we continue to share the word and include you in the services of our Mount Calvary church family. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn 727. Hymn 727, we begin.
To guard
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter suffering and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now and will be forever. Amen. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee. We glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us.
cross. Thou that takest away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Gracious Father, you call us by name. We belong to you, your treasured possessions in all the earth. And we pray that you anoint us by your Spirit, that we might be a kingdom of priests for the proclamation of your glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. The Old Testament lesson appointed for the second Sunday after Pentecost is from the 19th chapter of Exodus. They set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. On your wondrous works I will meditate, and I will declare your greatness.
The epistle lesson is from the fifth chapter of Paul's letter to the church in Rome. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. For sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 9th and the 10th chapters. Glory be to thee, O Lord. And Jesus went through all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And Jesus called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaan, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying. Give without pay." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated, and we'll sing hymn number 571. Hymn 571.
Declares how we are proud.
sins which you have done, and justified by Jesus' blood. Your baptism grants the highest good. If you are sick, if death is near, this truth your troubled heart can cheer. Christ Jesus saves your soul from death. That is the firmest ground of faith. Glory to God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three in one. To you all blessed Trinity, be praise now and eternally.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. A sermon text for this morning is from the 9th and 10th chapters of Matthew. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. So far the text. During the War of 1812, an ill-equipped and poorly funded army, a fledgling army of the United States, went to battle again against the nation of Great Britain to protect its freedom, its right to exist as a free republic. And you probably remember the last battle of that war, and it occurred in January of 1815, the Battle of New Orleans. It was a resounding American victory that launched Andrew Jackson to prominence in the national spotlight and eventually led to him becoming the president of the United States. The only sour note of the entire engagement was the timing involved. Weeks before the Battle of New Orleans, the Treaty of Ghent had been signed that ended the war. But nobody knew. In those days, of course, word of the ceasefire had to travel a long voyage across the Atlantic Ocean. And so they found out after many had lost their lives, many were wounded, many were captured. After that great victory, they found that they were fighting, really fighting for nothing. Rapid and clear communication is essential in wartime, and accurate information to be transmitted. Our modern military has the finest communications equipment known to man. Huge sums are spent by our nation to equip our fighting men and women as they go into battle to make sure that they can communicate important messages that will keep people safely on the battlefield, but also can help the nation to win wars. Well, as Jesus goes about in our gospel lesson, teaching in the synagogues and in the villages in Galilee, he's proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom from town to town, and we see the merciful and loving heart of God on display in Christ. These are the people for whom Jesus would die, and yet the text says they are like sheep without a shepherd. Their problem isn't that they didn't have a shepherd, but unfortunately their shepherds weren't true shepherds. In the verse just before our text, the Pharisees, the would-be leaders of the people, Jesus had done a great miracle, and instead of affirming him as the Messiah God had promised, the Pharisees are saying that Jesus is actually doing these miracles by the power of Satan. And so those false shepherds turned people away from the Messiah, Christ, the good shepherd who came to lay down his life for the sheep. Well, our text says that Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom. You remember John the Baptist, the great forerunner of Christ in his ministry. He began his ministry preaching the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And it's with those very same words that Jesus left his baptism in the Jordan and stepped out in proclaiming, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And now Jesus sends out his 12 with the same message on their lips. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Over and over again, the message never changes. The gospel of God's kingdom. Now the watchword of our age is change. The church must change. The church must change or she'll lose her young. They must adapt. The church must look and sound like the surrounding culture, or it can't survive. By the tyranny of the new, we are lured into surrendering the treasures of the past rather than bringing those truths to bear for a new generation. But is it worth it? Is it worth it to march in lockstep with a culture so out of step with God? Christian apologist Oz Guinness has written warning of a church obsessed with change. He said, in our rapidly changing world, the church that marries herself to the culture will always be a widow. Better to invite an ever-changing culture to find her rest in a God who never changes, a God who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. With tools and truths tried and true, we offer a living and faithful word, hoping that some will step off of the cultural treadmill and all of the societal changes and finally find their rest in the unchanging gospel of God's kingdom. This is the message that alone can calm our churning nation in these and in every day. No political movement of grievance and guilt offers the promise of true unity, but not unity within the church, not unity of political goals, rather unity as sinners humbled before our Almighty God's throne. Now, Jesus sent his 12 out to preach and to proclaim this changeless truth. In Jesus, the war is over. That's the message. The treaty that brings us eternal peace with God has been inscribed in Jesus' blood. In Jesus, there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, and we would add, neither black nor white. You are all one through faith in Christ Jesus. Jesus sent the 12, and he sent you and me also, because he wants the message to be heard. The war is over. In Christ, you have been reconciled by the blood of your Lord and Savior. The devil's kingdom has been overthrown by the heaven-born Prince of Peace. This is God's treaty that we are given to proclaim to a world in uproar. Many in every place yet lack Bible-believing pastors with the guts to speak with the prophets of old, thus saith the Lord. Within our own families and our neighborhoods, we each know friends or family members who have wandered from the fold of the Good Shepherd. That's why, as a congregation, we support Pastor Meeker and Deaconess Lorna. It's why we send money to our Central Illinois District and to our Lutheran Church Missouri Synod in partnership as we work for the kingdom of God in places that you and I will never go and never have opportunity to speak, yet God's word goes and we partner in sending. It's why we partner to train pastors and teachers through our colleges and our seminaries. It's why the Ladies' Aid collects their mites from month to month and brings together those mites to support the work of Christ's mission. It's why our wonderful teachers prepare themselves and proclaim the saving gospel to our young people in our preschool and in our Sunday school and in our vacation Bible school, we'll have to see where that goes and what opportunities will be there for that. But these aren't things that churches do simply because it's a good public relations kind of thing to do. We're sounding the trumpet. Jesus lives, the victory is won. The war is over. The harvest is plentiful. That lends an urgency for us, especially with our families and loved ones, people that we care deeply for. Our mission dollars as a congregation should never be a pittance of what's left over for the work of the kingdom. They are a sacred privilege to share in the mission of Christ, to bring Christ to the nations and the nations to the church, as the old Lutheran Hour slogan has it. Jesus said, the Son of Man will come at a day or an hour you do not expect. So during these days, these last days before the return of our Lord and Savior, dedicate yourselves in service to God with your dollars, with your time, with the talents that God's given you to put to work in His kingdom. Our text says, ask the Lord of the harvest that He send workers into His harvest field. And I want you to notice two things in those words, that Christ wants you to pray for pastors, teachers, and missionaries to go out harvesting souls for salvation by preaching the gospel. In the warfare of this world, your prayers are powerful weapons directed against the devil's crumbling kingdom, his defeated kingdom. So pray for young men to train to be pastors in our seminaries. Pray for young men and women to be teachers, to go out through the schools of our synod. Pray for young moms and dads as they shepherd their little lambs within their own homes and proclaim the word of life. Pray without ceasing, Paul said. Outside of the Lord's Prayer, this is the only petition that Jesus directs us specifically as His church to pray. Ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into His harvest field. See, God's church is a praying church, a church that lives on bended knee. Pray that God's word be spoken faithfully and fearlessly, that it not be buried or forgotten, crusading for political kingdoms and movements this side of heaven, faithfully speaking the good news of forgiveness in our Lord Jesus, and sounding God's call to repentance. And having spoken God's word, don't worry as you share that word that you can't change how someone receives it. It isn't a pastor's or a parent's brilliance and education and convincing ability that converts to faith. God's promises accomplish what He says. Isaiah tells us His word, God's word which proceeds from His mouth, will not return empty. It will accomplish the purposes for which He sent it. His word will bear fruit for the harvest on His own timetable and to His glory. Now, did you notice whose harvest field it is? The Lord of the harvest? See, it belongs to God. We all and everything belongs to God. God doesn't call you to responsibility for the results. They belong to Him. In 1 Corinthians, Paul said, I planted the seed, Apollos watered, but it's God who made it grow. Our mission for Christ, it's really Christ's mission through you and me for the world. You and I don't have the power, but God's word does. It's living and active. God's word is sharper than any double-edged sword. Though heaven and earth will pass away, Jesus said, my word will never pass away. Jesus promised that the gates of hell can never prevail against the church of Christ. And Romans 1 says the gospel is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes. Now I want to draw your attention to one little word. It's one word in our Greek, in the Greek text, but one word in our Greek text, a phrase that's translated here. The word is splunknidzomai in your verses for today. And it says, Jesus had compassion on the crowds. And that's the splunknidzomai, the Greek word. That word speaks of God's love. And it really means, it means a twisting, almost, you know, somebody who's fallen in love to the point where their stomach aches and their hearts, this, it physically affects them. That's the word that Jesus describes as he looks out and sees the people harassed and helpless as sheep without a shepherd, a gut-wrenching longing. It's the same word Luke 15 uses. The prodigal son takes his dad's inheritance and he goes far away and he squanders it and he's face down the pig slop. And finally, when he comes home, his father sees him at a distance. And it says he has that gut-twisting, wrenching love for his son that causes him to run to him and to throw his arms around him and restore him, his son, to his family. That's the love that your triune God has for you. Jesus looks out at you and me, his children, harassed and helpless, sheep without shepherds, with a gut-twisting longing. And Christ didn't go to the cross. You think about it, he didn't go to the cross because he thought the resurrection would be some kind of a neat trick to pull or a wonderful little miracle he could do. He went because we couldn't do a thing on our own. And God demonstrated, our epistle says, his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God demonstrated his love in that great work. Jesus lived a perfect life to take your place and mine, so that by his forgiving love, you and I could have heaven's perfect peace. The war is over. Christ's love is not an empty emotion, but it is an eternal and undying commitment, ultimate sacrifice. He chose to die to reconcile you to your Father in heaven through Spirit-given faith. He chose to die so that you wouldn't have to, and that the whole world could live not under the threat of eternal death, but in the promise of the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ. God's mission through you and me is the same as it was for his chosen people of the Old Testament in Exodus 19, those verses that we read. He gathered his children at Mount Sinai in our lesson. For them and for you, this is so. You are my treasured possession among all the peoples. All the earth is mine, and you shall be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may in such wise hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of thy holy word we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. May be seated. We'll close with hymn 827. Hymn 827.
harvest waiting, who will bear the sheaves away? Loud and long the Master calleth, rich reward he offers me. Who will answer gladly, saying, Here am I, send me, send me. Someday the business in morning, to their Lord responding soon. Some are called in heat of midday, others wake in afternoon. Even as the sun is setting, some are sent into the fields. There together in the bounty that God's word so richly yields. For as rain and snow from heaven, water seeds in dusty soil, causing them to bud and flower, giving bread to those who toil. So the Lord sends forth his promise, words of hope and joy and peace. Never for to him returning, bearing fruit with great increase. Marks the time when grace shall end, when with his angelic creepers he in glory shall descend. Soon the night of